Mike Zielinski Show. I am Mike Zielinski. I'm honored today to have as my guest Johanny Cepeda, who is the new executive director of the Berks County Latino Chamber of Commerce. And so many people know her in the community because she is the owner of Mi Casa, Su Casa, and also Mi Casa, Su Casa, the Goggle Works. Awesome food, and I am a longtime customer, love your Cuban pork sandwiches, and welcome.
Thank you.
So, how's things going? I don't know, because I know you're also involved in a lot of committees in the city of Reading. You're a mom, you have two children. How do you balance it all?
Well, I think the beauty of it all is that Mi Casa, Su Casa, that's really my casa. So everything pretty much happens out of there. I run my business. I'm able to host meetings, gather people at my place of business. Also with the Latino Chamber of Commerce, it's a virtual office. So all the work that I do it out of my shop as well. My kids after school come to my shop. So I think the beauty of being a business owner in this case is that I have that flexibility. I have my own space, so I'm more in control of my time, sort of speak. Now it doesn't always work out that way, but...
Because your background isn't in food, right?
Not at all.
Yeah, I didn't think it was. Yeah,
I enjoy eating.
But what did you, tell our viewers what you did, because I know you lived in New York.
Yes, in New York City, I used to run a community center. So working with the community has always been innate for me. It's like my
vocation. So that's where it comes from.
That's where it comes from. I have a master's degree in counseling. So while running a community center in New York City, I also, which was located in a school building in the Lower East Side of Manhattan, I also worked for the school as a part-time guidance counselor.
Oh, okay.
So I did, and my focus, my area of focus was college counseling. So I worked with 9th through 12th grade doing workshops, and then more focused with the seniors for financial aid, college application, college tours. I would host two college fairs at the school.
Wow. So quite a transition to what you're
doing I've now. Always, and with the community center, I mean, I've always been able to multitask. Everything was in the same school building. So morning had college counselor, evening I was the director of this community center. And we did things from academic assistance for ages 6 through 12. We also did martial arts, we did job clubs, we did, an array, sports. So we also provided programs for teenagers, teenage pregnancy prevention. We also did more college and career discovery. We also ran tournaments in the evening, basketball tournaments for the harder to reach kids or also labeled as at-risk youth, just to get them engaged.
You're so excited talking about this. Why did you leave that?
You know what? I had my own, for so many years, I was helping raise community and raise other children. Then when I started having my own, I was missing out on my own children's milestones. So I wasn't there
Never
when they were
thing.
Potty trained. I wasn't.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Maybe that's a good thing.
So I felt like after my second child was born, I needed to do something different because I wanted to see my kids grow. I wanted to be actively involved in their life.
Yeah.
So when, I would always visit Reading. I've been coming to
Your
Reading.
Your mom lives
Yeah,
there, right?
I've been coming to Reading since 16.
Okay.
I remember during one of my college summer breaks, I worked at the VF outlet, at the Fila outlet.
Okay.
Yeah, I did one summer there. So I would always come to Reading, and I knew that this would be the place where I could raise my children, and it would be a nice balanced, nice paced type of environment for my kids. So when my son, he turned 2 here in Reading, when the opportunity came up for me to open up Mi Casa, Su Casa, we had to jump on it. And my kids have been raised there pretty much.
Well, I've seen your kids there a lot.
Yeah.
But was anyone in your family helpful with food?
You know what? My dad.
I thought your dad was involved.
Yes. Yeah. My dad is my cook.
Okay.
And since I can remember, and I hope my mom, if she's watching, please don't kill me. I love your food too. But my dad, he was the best cook to me.
Yeah. He must be. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. You know what? He does everything with love, passion. He grew up learning how to cook in his mother's kitchen.
Okay.
He was always in his, always in the kitchen.
Did he do that professionally?
No, not at all. He just loves it.
So he did it when you started the business?
Professionally,
yes.
Yeah. Otherwise, he just always cooked at home. He was the one that, it's funny because they always would switch roles. My mom was like the main breadwinner, and my dad would oftentimes be, he wasn't a stay-at-home dad. He had buildings. He was a superintendent of numerous buildings.
Okay.
So he would stay home a lot because that's, you know, he had to deal with like tenant complaints and things like that. No, so he always cooked.
It's more fun to cook.
Yeah, he was always home or close to home.
So you're at 345 Penn Street with the Mi Casa.
320 Penn Street.
Oh, 345 is the Reading Eagle, which I spent a lot of time. Okay, 320 Penn Street, right across the street.
Right across the street.
And you're also at the Goggle Works.
Yes, at 201 Washington Street.
And you were just telling me before we started the show that you're expanding your hours there a little
bit. Yes. So the Goggle Works has gone through some transition. And they have an acting director currently, and the hours of the building have been expanded from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. So this week we began opening up at 9 a.m. And we're doing right now 9 a.m. to 4, and we're going to be adding hours gradually.
You're doing that for two reasons, I would believe. Obviously, you want to make some money, but also because you're trying to support a good organization.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, yes. Before we became part of the Goggle Works team, the cafe area was vacant for almost a year.
Yeah, I remember one. Yeah.
So I was recruited by a good friend of ours, Tom McMahon. He said, would you give this an opportunity? Would you give it a chance? We worked out some great deals with the prior executive director, and we've been there since. And trying, you know, it's been a challenge. You know, I believe that the Goggle Works is such a gold mine. It could be the attraction of the city of Reading. So just like, you know, it's work in progress. We're making it better.
Okay, so now with the Latino, I know you have a lot of ambitious programs.
Yes, I do.
And I took a few notes, but I guess the chamber, because a lot of people didn't realize there was a Latino Chamber of Commerce, decided they needed someone in a paid position. You're part-time, but they needed someone that couldn't just be all volunteers.
Right.
And if they were going to pick a face, because I know they were looking for a face of the Latino Chamber, everybody knows you. You're the perfect face.
Thank you.
And some of your goals, I think, you're working on, and if you could expand, I know it's marketing, networking, education, and advocacy. Let's start with the marketing. What are you doing?
Okay, so thank you for asking. So since I took on the position, we've partnered with El Palo magazine. So all new members to the Latino Chamber of Commerce will receive a free subscription to El Palo magazine, a one-time free ad in El Palo magazine, and then discounts. If you want to continue advertising in El Palo, you'll get great discounts. In addition, you will also get discounts on any promotional materials like flyers, business cards. Mm-hmm. So Rosa Julia and Alex Parra, who's also from known as DJ Chamo King, we've developed a great partnership so that we can make these services more available to our members. So that's marketing and networking. Also, our website, we're revamping it so that our members, there'll be a business directory. So if you're looking for hairstylists, you can look under stylist or hair salons. Boom, all the Latino members, all the business owners will come up. We're trying to make the website more interactive, more user-friendly, so that people can access it and get the information that they need and also post information to market their businesses.
And are you doing networking events too?
Yes, thank you.
For minority
Absolutely.
Owners?
Absolutely. So for networking, you know, I believe in not reinventing the wheel. If we have something that exists, let's partner up and let's enhance it. So we've also partnered up with La Unión Colombiana, and we do diversity mixers. So it's a networking event with professionals from all backgrounds. So for example, and it's held every first Wednesday of the month.
Oh, you have them monthly?
They're monthly.
And they're at different places?
They're at different venues.
They're not just at Mi Casa.
No. And the goal with the diversity mixers and why we do it at different venues is because it's an opportunity to expose the business, to give that business or that venue's owner an opportunity to showcase what they have to offer. And then people can also mingle, exchange cards. And it's very structured. So people get a chance to speak.
Okay.
And people also, at these networking events, what happens is like speed dating. So your time, okay, now meet someone new. And then, okay, time's up, next.
Oh, that's really clever.
Yeah, it's fun. Because I think particularly for Latino business owners who may not be accustomed to network, they don't know how to.
Right.
So it's kind of like, okay, well, this is how you also do it.
Now, let me ask you this. You're unusual because you can multitask, and obviously you've proven that over the years. But when you're a business owner, and you know more than I do, but your time, I mean, you're focused on that. Mm-hmm. How much is there a sense of a collective good among Latino businesses that you think, hey, we all have to be supportive of each other because we're all in this together, or are they so singularly focused on their own business they may not have the time or the opportunity to think that way?
Okay, so I've been in business now a little over 8 years, and I am not the expert because I still struggle with time management sometimes. I realized, though, with speaking with my business neighbors, Latino business owners, that they struggle letting go. You know, because it's not the same when you're not there, for example, or delegating sometimes I think is hard for us. But as I'm going.
Oh, I see. So yeah, the good thing is to have people you're comfortable with. You can do that with family or whatever.
Right. It's hard to allocate time for something other than your business.
Right.
And I find that.
And you feel guilty if you do, right?
Yes. Yeah. So it's a matter, like for me, it was also very challenging. And, you know, it's like I was giving myself therapy. That's where my counseling background came in. And I said, I have to let go and I have to trust and I have to walk in faith, not fear.
Right, yeah.
So as I talk to some of my business neighbors who I've been speaking about the chamber, you know, it's helping them understand, like, your business is going to be okay. Sometimes you need to get out of your business so you can develop another perception.
Right.
So you can work on your business, not work the business, but work on the business from outside.
And you can build a business from
absolutely.
Outside without, yeah, because
absolutely.
If you spent your whole day, and thank God for your dad, but if you spent your whole day making food.
I'd be stuck.
Yeah.
Like that's as far as I would grow or expand.
Right.
So, you know, with our seminars, which probably leads us to the education component.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that because, you know, I know you're affiliated with Kutztown University.
Yes, with the Latino Business Resource Center. And they have a 12-week course starting in March.
Is Ernie Post, is he the overseer of that? Or
Ernie Post is the director.
He's correct. My neighbor.
Is he?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Oh,
yeah.
My gosh. I mean, he's amazing.
He
learned
is.
So much
from
Ernie Post.
Yeah, we talk about the city a lot.
Yeah, I bet. So I, you know, I had met with the former director of the Latino Business Resource Center, and we identified a list of key trainings and seminars that I like for us to work on to provide for our members. And one of them is as simple as, you know, accounting, marketing, and marketing to a diverse group, not just people that you're comfortable with,
mm-hmm.
right? We talked about the importance of payroll and paying taxes on all your hires, and not to, because I think oftentimes you'll find, and I'm not trying to get anyone in trouble, but that sometimes, you know, some of these businesses will pay their staff under the table, for example. So they're missing out on a tax benefit,
mm-hmm.
right?
Because they don't know how to do it the right way.
They don't know how, exactly.
How much of a challenge is this for the ones who aren't very good in English? Because, you know, I know we have a very predominant Latino community, but, you know, English is something, especially in the business world, you have to have some familiarity
right.
with.
So I want to say that I always admire those people that can attain success with all these barriers, with these limited English speaking skills. They know how to make money.
Yeah.
So then my goal is I'm going place to place.
Money,
I'm
assessing. Money trumps all languages.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. Right. And it's, you know, figuring out, like, I don't know if you've ever seen shows like Tabitha Takeover. It's about hair salons, or Restaurant Impossible. It's about restaurants. But I like, one of my goals is to kind of like also build a team that we can go into some of these establishments and assess where they're at and figure out and then tailor programs to meet their needs. So like when I speak to some of the business owners, you know, they don't know that they're missing out on tax benefits
as
we speak because they're not taking out the time to maybe hire someone who could do their payroll, for example. Or sometimes maybe they're paying someone to do their sales taxes when it's something they can do from their computer. They can do it online. So there's a lot of things that our business owners need to learn that they don't necessarily have to speak English to know how to do it.
Okay.
But you're right. And even for myself, obviously I speak the language, but being new to business, because remember, I come from nonprofit. So starting my own business, I remember it was through one of these workshops held by the Latino Business Resource Center that I learned that I had to pay sales taxes, that I needed a sales tax license. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Starting out, I was very green. And thanks to some of the workshops that I attended, I started really legitimizing my business.
Why is it, do you think, because there are so many challenges mm-hmm. in starting your own businesses, business and such a risk, why do so many people do it, especially in the Latino community? Is it because there aren't jobs elsewhere or they don't have the training? But it's a challenge to do this. Why do you think, and I have no idea, and it's a question I did, I mean, how many Latino minority-owned businesses are there in Berks County?
Well, the last time I checked stats, and I could be, you have to correct me on this, I mean, I think first, when we look at, like, I'm going to focus on the city of Reading, the population, I believe, is at 62% Hispanic, Latino,
somewhere there.
Right? And then, but when I had checked prior, it was at that point, it was at 53, I think, several years ago. And then 27 were Latino business, were business owners.
27%. Yeah.
Right. So I thought it was a huge number. I'm like, wow, how did, you know, and I think
it's
that.
It's not, because I would think that would be.
I think, no, I think it's a huge number, absolutely. Yeah. And I think, you know, having lived in the Dominican Republic, as I did to about 5 years of my life, went to school there, whatever, you know, when I compare the cultures there and here, when people come into this country, Latinos, for the most part, you know, this is the land of opportunities. It's like either if you can't make it, you can create the opportunity. I'm sorry, if you don't find the opportunity, you create the opportunity.
And you can't create the opportunity as much there. So is that right. why you think so right. many go into business on their
yes.
own?
Yes.
Because they didn't come here for the wonderful winter weather.
No, not at all. And, you know, I've come into contact with some people who are also professionals, who may be doctors, engineers, but, you know, when they come into this country, they have to, you know, there's a set of certifications that they need. And if they don't know the English language, then it's like they're stuck.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
they try to find creative ways to generate income. So you'll see a lot of entrepreneurs, if they don't have a brick and mortar type of business, they'll definitely be entrepreneurs, and they find some other forms, network marketing.
Do you consider yourself an entrepreneur?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, it's funny because I thought my nonprofit management kind of prepared me, believe it or not, for what I'm doing now with my business. Because it's like you learn in the nonprofit world to be creative, how you pay Peter by taking from Paul. I know you've heard the term.
Yeah.
But you learn to be so creative that I'm fortunate that I had that experience that I've been able to apply in business. Because it's very challenging.
Yeah, I'm sure it is.
It has a lot of challenges.
Which is why it's good that you can help counsel them at times. You're
well,
perfect
that's
for
a whole nother
role.
Topic.
Now, what about the advocacy? I know you have some plans you want to interface with City Hall, and it's probably the perfect timing for you because our new mayor, Wally Scott, is very attuned mm-hmm. to what the demographics of the city are
right.
these days, and very reaching out to the Latino community. Where are you? What do you want to do, and where are you at with it?
One of my first goals is, again, if it's a challenge for someone who speaks English, who's from here, to open up and start a business in the city of Reading, imagine the non-English speaker.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. Now, I can't imagine being where everything was in Spanish. I couldn't pull it off.
Well, right. So yeah. Given the demographics, I think one of my first goals is that I want to be able to get any business documents in Spanish. Can we have bilingual documents? Something as simple as that. That's where I like to start.
But it's probably expensive, isn't it?
But if, again, let's be creative. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of nonprofit entities, properties that are tax exempt, who will contribute a service in lieu of tax.
Yeah, and there are a lot of tax exempt properties in the city, as
right.
you know.
And we
yeah.
have, so why not say, yeah. hey, would you mind translating these documents for us? I don't see why they wouldn't. I'm sure they've yeah. never been asked. I mean, we have the Hispanic Center.
You always hear, though, that because there's different dialects in Spanish, you know, Puerto Rican, Mexican, Dominican, and that when you put something in Spanish, there are differences. Is that overstated?
I think when you speak, speaking is one thing, but what grammar is, you know, it's consistent.
So it's
consistent.
So it's not going to read silly to someone
no.
from Dominican.
No, it's pretty standard.
Descent.
No.
And it's. Okay.
Yeah, it's almost like when the English language, like you have slang words that you utilize as you're
okay.
having conversations.
Okay.
You kind of make stuff up sometimes, right? But no, it's but the
I mean,
English
we had that
written,
for generations of Pennsylvania Dutch. I don't know what some of those words have meant over the years. Of course, that's kind of waning, but you know.
Mm-hmm.
I see that. And so, how's that? Have you started reaching out to people about that, nonprofits or?
No, not as of yet, because first I want to get to City Hall and see what the capacity is.
Yeah. Also, I think I saw an article in the paper where you also would like the city administration to help you with a database of what new, existing, and struggling Latino businesses.
Well, if they would have that,
right, you know.
Right. I definitely would like some type of database, because I think that City Hall, I mean, we want to attract businesses, we want to sustain businesses, we want to expand businesses, right? Because it'll stimulate our economy as a city. And as you know, we're in this economic distress. So I believe that if we prioritized a little bit that department, I believe it comes from the Community Economic Department, mm-hmm. and have, you know, and expand on that one-stop shop that they offer weekly, mm-hmm. and then have documents that are also in Spanish, I think we can provide a greater service to our business owners.
Yes, yeah.
And we can also help them be in compliance and not get hit with fines because maybe they didn't understand.
Yeah, when you're in business, compliance is a tough word.
It is a tough word.
Yeah,
but it's a requirement. Yeah, otherwise, you get stuck with fines, the threat of shutting you down. So I want to be able to prevent that. And I want to be able for there to be a base at City Hall that they're ready in tune to who's coming, who's going, who's struggling, so that we can address that need.
Well, speaking of struggling, it was my understanding that all businesses, Latino or otherwise, there's a high failure rate. It's hard to, you know, a lot of businesses, they start, but they don't, you know, they're not successful. Do you have any idea what the success rate in Berks County?
I don't.
Yeah.
I'd have to do some research
to
answer that question.
Now, we've talked about the city a lot, but there's more and more, the primary concentration of Latino population has traditionally been in the city, but mm-hmm. that's changing, is it not?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So are there more businesses in the suburbs that are Latino-owned?
Yeah, well, if you go to West Reading, if you go to Wyomissing, absolutely. If you go
West Lawn.
Yeah. They're definitely,
maybe Muhlenberg,
we've been expanding in Muhlenberg as well. Yeah, there's plenty. I just wanted to start locally first and then expand. I want to strengthen this, and then that could be my pilot or my model as to
Yeah, because the majority of them are in the city.
Right.
I've asked you this off the air, but on the air, you're not officially affiliated with the Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce and Industry, but they're very supportive.
Yes. So as a Mi Casa, Su Casa business, I am a member of the Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce. However, the Latino Chamber of Commerce, it's its own entity. But yes, we have developed great partnerships with the Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce and collaboration efforts, or collaborative efforts,
because they're so broad-based. They can't have a singular focus like you can.
Right.
Yeah.
And they've been very welcoming to us. Very supportive. Ellen Horan, I mean, has invited me to her staff meetings, always makes me aware of like workshops or seminars, whoever's coming to visit them. So for example, on the 17th, I'm attending a meeting with an SBA person. There's a meeting to be held at the Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce regarding a new program. Program for business owners, like a loan type of program.
Okay.
So she's always including me. And I'm very appreciative. The Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce, even their member services director, I mean, spent like an hour or two with me going over what she offers her members and what the packages look like. So they have been very supportive of us.
Now, I know you're the only paid person mm-hmm. At the Latino Chamber of Commerce, but you're not doing this all alone, right? Are there volunteers helping you?
Well, board members.
We
have an amazing board of directors, and they're very, I mean, they're diligent. I'm sorry.
No,
I got a little
okay.
distracted, yeah. Sorry. But yeah, so the board members are very
helpful.
Are
they all Latino, if I may
No,
ask?
They're diverse. They're multicultural.
Okay.
You know, one of the things, even though we're focusing on the Latino business owners, but I'm very inclusive.
Well, because you know what? There are other minority. But that's a good point, because I know in the city, I mean, we have Indian restaurants.
Mm-hmm.
They're Vietnamese.
Right.
There are other
right.
ethnic groups
right.
in
yeah,
business.
We're very multicultural in our city, which is a beautiful thing. It's just, you know, let me focus on this area and then we'll keep expanding. And then maybe, you know, who knows what we can develop with the Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce, because they have an amazing infrastructure. And
yeah.
They've been around for over a decade. So
now, being a community activist in New York, and you are here too, and I know like you go in your store, your restaurant, there's always flyers supporting something or the other. You've had political ambitions. I know you've run for council.
Yes.
Will you run, and especially now in this networking that you're doing, are you going to run again, do you think?
Yeah, that's it. Yes.
Yeah.
I'm going to answer yes.
Yeah.
You know, I believe that if we begin organizing people, right now I'm going to be organizing them through business. I mean, they have, I mean, they're assets to our city. And I can then begin, then I can also simultaneously start organizing community, then I think that our city will be in a better place because now we get the people engaged in the process.
Yeah.
We get them involved. They take ownership. So they're going to maintain their streets clean. They're going to maintain their streets safe. You know what I mean? We have to teach people how to,
yeah,
how to has take to be... on more responsibilities in their immediate neighborhoods.
So we started this by saying that you moved from New York because you wanted more time with your kids.
Right,
how's that
I
working
know.
Out now, John?
You know what? They, I know they don't like it as much, but I drag them with me everywhere I go.
They're going to be community activists.
Absolutely. They don't understand it now, but they will thank me later because I'm teaching them skills. And even when I did my when I was running for city council and during my campaign process, I would take them with me. Some would help me. My son would give out flyers. My daughter would sometimes take notes like, okay, we took it to this house. We took it to that house. So she was very, she started reading the paper with me and, you know, became very interested in politics and what the dynamics and who's
great.
Doing what
that's
and
great
what's
that
happening
you're inclusive
now.
With them.
Yeah.
So
it's important. I want it to be very much a part of their lives just as much as I want them to be a part of my life. So yes, mommy's busy, but you know, it's all about balance. We can get it all done.
Now you must, you know, I think the people who have the ability to multitask have an innate capacity to compartmentalize that when you're focused on Mi Casa, that's what you're focusing on, correct? And then if you're focusing on the Latino or just being mom, you know, yeah.
I keep,
can you adjust
you know, I keep
your
two
mindset?
Notebooks, one for the chamber and one for Mi Casa Su Casa. So like I knew I was going to focus on chamber. My blue notebook for the chamber is in my bag.
Okay.
My red notebook for Mi Casa Su Casa is at the shop. But there's always overlap in my brain. Yeah, it's weird if I started to describe to you how my brain works and how I start organizing things in my head. And then the rest of my body does what it needs to do to get things done.
Well, it's working out for you. Hey, you've been a delightful guest, very
Thank
informative.
You.
Best of luck with the Latino Chamber of Commerce
Thank
initiative
you.
And also much success for Mi Casa Su Casa at both locations.
Yes,
and,
thank you.
And, you know, we're out of time, but real quickly, is there a number you want to tell people to call you if they have a question about the Latino Chamber?
Yes, and the number to call is 610-616-5610, or please email me at Johanny Cepeda, JohannyCepeda at latinochamber.net. And otherwise, you can always come see me at 320 Penn Street at Mi Casa Su Casa. My doors are always open.
And get the Cuban pork sandwich while you're there.
Yeah.
All right, we're running late. Take care. Thanks for
Thank
watching.
Thank you.